One thing that we will be doing the OCI TCO giveaway at the end of this talk, so don't run away at the end, stick around, and my colleague Jeff Brown at the back will be in charge of that. Thanks for attending. All those who came at great conf, it's been another great year, and hopefully you've all seen that all the exciting things that are going on in the Grails and Groovy and communities. So this talk will hopefully also reinforce that, as I'll be talking about what is new and wonderful in the world of Grails. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Graeme Rocher. I'm the project lead of Grails at OCI, and I've been working on Grails for 10 years now, I think. So, yeah. If you're looking for somebody, a recruiter is looking for somebody with more than 10 years experience, I think I'm the only guy out there. It's been a fun ride, and long may it continue. So in terms of a status update, Grails 3 we're currently at the 3.1.8, is the current stable release of Grails. 3.0.x and 2.x are in maintenance mode, and we continue to evolve the 3.1 branch. And we're still making that progress in migrating the Grails 2.x plugins. I think the majority of the important ones are migrated. If you're still on Grails 2 or you're thinking about jumping to Grails 3, now is a great time to consider making that choice. A lot of good stuff in there. We also want to just reach out and say thanks to the Agile Orbit crew for helping us out, setting up a new plugin portal for Grails 3, which was something that was missing when we first released it. It's now far better to navigate and get around and find what plugins are available. So kudos to those guys for doing that. Another thing I want to point out is if you haven't signed up for Slack, it's a great way to engage with the community. All of the key Grails devs are on there. I'm on there. The OCI team are on there. Great place to come and ask questions, engage with the community, find direction for your problems that you encounter with either Groovy or Grails. It's easy to sign up. It's browser-based, so you don't have to install anything. They do have native apps if you do want to install something. So, it's pretty cool and a great way to engage with the community. So just a recap then on Grails 3. So who is using Grails 3 is the question. More hands, and who's using Grails 2 mainly? A lot of hands. So we're trying to get more of those folks who are using Grails 2 to use Grails 3, and this talk will hopefully reinforce some of the concepts and ideas and direction and great features that are included in Grails 3 to encourage you to use it and upgrade and so forth. So it's based on a new architecture. So one of the things we wanted to reinforce is that all those people saying comparing Spring Boot to Grails or saying it's an either or. Well, Grails is built on top of Spring Boot. So if you're using Grails, you're also using Spring Boot. So it's not really a comparison. We built it on top of Gradle as the build system. It's got a profile mechanism so that that you can construct different kinds of applications for different use cases. So whether you're building a Angular app or a REST based app or a traditional request response servlet application, we have a profile for you. But the philosophy is the same. That's important. You still have the conventions, the familiarity of knowing where your controllers are, where your services are, where your domain model is. The plugin ecosystem is still there. Focus on dry and all the great features of Groovy to make it robust and powerful. And as I said, the application profiles is a big deal that we're trying to evolve and push forward on the platform. You know, the world has changed. It's not just, you know, traditional request response web applications anymore. There's a whole bunch of use cases that are where applications are primarily just REST APIs serving mobile or rich client rich clients, single page apps, or SPA is the term of the day, I think. And you got different data usages. And the NoSQL world is maturing with you know, fantastic products like MongoDB and Neo4j and so forth, and the tendency to build much more microservices. So Grails is expanding its reach through application profiles, and we think that Grails 3 is a solid base for the future. And also want to reinforce that, you know, we're evolving Grails 3 rapidly, but we're not going to just spring Grails 4 anytime soon. I've heard the word Grails 4 mentioned so many times, but we're very much focused on stability of the platform and building on top of the base that we've created with Grails 3. The foundational components are stable. It's a great time to jump into plugin development if you have any plugins and want to contribute there. And improvements are coming all the time. We've started a policy of trying to do a point release every couple of weeks. So every couple of weeks we do a minor patch release, so that you don't have to wait a long time for bug fixes and so forth and so on. So we're evolving the platform rapidly. And so after 3.0, the big 3.0 release, came 3.1. Grails 3.1, and what did 3.1 introduced? So Grails 3 was based on Spring Boot 1.2 and Spring 4.1. So Grails 3.1 is based on Spring Boot 1.3 and Spring 4.2. It's the first release where we really made the profile mechanism flexible. So profiles in Grails 3.1 are just jar files, and you can create your own profiles. So for example, imagine for a second that you have an organization where you want every developer in your organization to have a pre-configured data source, a pre-configured set of plugins, a pre-configured environment. You can create a profile that populates the default dependencies when you create an application so that your developers can quickly spin up a new application and be up and running and productive without having to go, where did I put those database settings, or how do I configure this, or where's my backend REST service configuration, or, you know, all that kind of little minor details, config, project setup stuff that's annoying to get going when you're starting a new project. With 3.1, we also introduced the new REST profile, REST API profile, and the AngularJS profile. And if you had been to my GORM talk, and the lucky ones who attended that before this talk, I talked a lot more in detail about GORM 5. But today, we want to announce the next major milestone of Grails 3 line, which is Grails 3.2. So Grails 3.2, we're targeting a release, GA release in the next few months, and it's you know, based on that same key platform that the three line is. So there's not going to be any problem upgrading from 3.1 to 3.2 or from 3.0 to 3.2. But most of the enhancements that we're adding to 3.2 are plugins to the platform or minor tweaks to the Grails 3 line. We're focusing on a few key areas, one major push is RX GORM. So RX GORM is a reactive implementation of GORM. So if you're interested in building completely non-blocking applications, then RxGolem is going to be the solution for you. We're going to launch RxGolem with support for MongoDB and a REST client implementation, and then we'll be extending it to support SQL databases in GOM 7, the next major release after that. And as for GOM itself, we're also introducing multi-tenancy support, which will support both RxGolem and normal GOM in terms of allowing you to build multi-tenant applications, whether it be with a single database or multiple databases or schema-based, or you know, completely flexible, but not tied to a single database implementation. So we want our multi-tenancy support to be non-database specific, so that it's usable in MongoDB, it's usable in Neo4j, it's usable in your traditional relational database development applications. We're also working on GOM for Neo4j 3. We're working together with a client who is using that in production, and so it's a great way to develop features for GOM, because we know that that feature is being used in a real-world scenario. So GOM for Neo4j 3, which will support the new binary protocol for Neo4j called Bolt. We're also announcing AngularJS scaffolding support. So if you're building AngularJS applications and you want to get up and running quickly with the Grails backend, AngularJS scaffolding will help you get there quicker and understand how to build AngularJS applications with Grails. And we're continuing to refine the REST support. As I said, regarding the profile improvements, in 3.1, we introduced the notion of profiles just being jar files, and we have the team working on continuing improving those profiles and creating new profiles. So we anticipate in Grails 3.2 and the Grails 3.1 line, you'll see new profiles for things like React, or profiles for Webpack, profiles for potentially in the future different container backend implementations, whether that be Netty, and we're going to continue to evolve that. So I'm going to take you through some of the new features of Grails 3.1 and 3.2. One of those is the REST profile. It allows the easy creation of REST APIs, and the customizability is key because it's all done through JSON views. The profile itself has support for security, so it's easy to spin up security support via support for Spring Security REST. Built-in integration, unit and functional testing. And the profile adapts the command line to be specific to building REST APIs. So instead of, for example, the generate all command, instead of generating GSP views, which you wouldn't want for a REST application, it generates JSON views, which I'll talk about in a moment. And there's specific commands for creating RESTful controllers, providing a more focused environment. I mentioned JSON views briefly, but they are essentially restoring the V in MVC when it comes to building REST APIs for your Grails applications. So we noticed that when people were building REST applications with Grails, too much logic was being placed in either controllers or in marshallers or in other places that didn't feel like it fit in a natural MVC architecture. So what we decided to do is design a new view technology from the ground up that is designed specifically to help you produce JSON responses. A JSON view is essentially a Groovy script. Here's a very trivial example where it uses JSON streaming JSON builder, which is part of Groovy itself, to construct your JSON responses. The views themselves are statically compiled by default, although you can change it to be dynamically compiled if you want, but by default, so that they are performant, fast, in execution and rendering, and also to catch any mistakes in your when defining your model. And I'm going to give you a demo of how they work. Okay, so I have a project here, which I created earlier, a JSON view example. I'm just going to import it into IntelliJ so that we can have a look at how they work. Okay, so this is a project that I used the create app command and the REST API profile. So you can see here we have what looks like a traditional Grails application, and I can start up my Grails command line, and you can see if I tab, we have all the regular commands for working with Grails application, but you can see some of those profile-specific commands, for example, create RESTful controller or create domain resource for creating GORM-backed domain objects. But of greater interest here is if we look at the views directory. So in a traditional Grails application, you would expect the views directory to contain GSP files, right? But because this is a REST application, instead of GSP files, what we have is JSON views. And if we look at them, for example, this is the one, the view that gets rendered whenever an exception occurs in your application. You can see that it sets the response status to 500 and outputs an internal server error message, which will produce a JSON response with two keys, message and error. Message having the value of internal server error and error having an integer value, producing your JSON. Same thing for all of your not found responses. You have a not found.json. So the whole application is set up. Interestingly as well, you've got an errors directory where you have an errors.json. So whenever a validation error occurs, like for example, if you're trying to do a perform a post and your domain class, your validation fails, this errors.json will get rendered, so you get an error response sent back to the client for any invalid domain instances that are posted. So one of the things we can try out then is creating a domain class. It doesn't really matter what it's called. We'll go with person. And populating some properties. And then what we can do, maybe add age or something, what we can do is run generate all and generate the views. Then we can open up our URL mappings and add an endpoint called people that maps to our person controller. So if we look at the controller, the person controller, as you can see, is a normal Grails controller that performs CRUD operations. But you'll notice that it's more tailored, ignoring all of the requirements around supporting an HTML UI. It's just producing JSON responses. And if we look at the views that were generated, so we've got a person directory here, and you can see that I have in here a couple of views. So we have an index view, and the index view takes an iterable of person and renders a template using the template namespace. So the template namespace is a bit like the GSP template namespace, where if you use this temple prefix and call a method, it will attempt to find a template that matches this method name. And as it happens, just like in GSP, templates start with underscore. So we have an underscore person.json, and that renders out the person. So you can see that the underscore person.json takes a person in the model and renders, using the g.render method, renders out the person. Now, the g.render method is a utility method. So just like in GSP, there is a g namespace, and there's a whole bunch of utility methods in there. for rendering objects and creating links and so forth. But if you prefer to create your own custom JSON responses, you can, of course, like, I don't know, if your JSON for some bizarre reason decided not to use first, you could say person.firstname and so forth. Another thing that you can do in the most recent version of the JSON views plugin is to use the field transform, so that way you get navigation into your model properties and so forth. So instead of having to use the model block, so you can provide last name. And you can completely customize the output of your JSON within your view. Yeah, if you don't want to have to hard code all the different properties, I mean, this is kind of this would be useful if, say, for example, in the future version of your application, you change your API. You can do something like gRender person includes first name. And pass in a closure, and you only rename the last name property for some reason. So that will give you the output. G.render would handle the rendering of the first name property, but then you could rename the last name property to something else. Yeah. So you get complete flexibility on how you control the output. There's a whole API in here. For example, there's a request object. Where you can get hold of headers and contact method and so forth. There's a params object where you can read parameters from the request if necessary. There's also the ability to use HAL as a response format. So instead of just producing JSON, HAL is a standard format for representing links between JSON I think it also supports XML, but anyway. Primarily JSON responses. So there's a HAL property, and you can say HAL.render person. And in this case, it'll produce JSON with embedded links. Let's just try G.render and person, and then open up Bootstrap and create a couple of these people. And run the application and see what happens. Okay. Run the application and let's see what happens when we open this up in a browser. Okay. Right, I realize what I did. They don't have ages. Okay. Run that. And now if we go back to our browser, we should see some JSON output appearing for those objects. There we go. So that's the default output that's getting generated. And if we go to /people to an individual one, we get the individual JSON response rendered by our JSON views. If we come in here and try to use a HAL output, let's see what happens. Save that. You see we get HAL links. So I just by changing the output format to HAL, we get a whole bunch of HAL links, which is pretty cool. We can customize the HAL output. For example, I could say HAL.inline my object in here, and I could say HAL how links generated for person. And you could say how I want embedded some embedded other person just as a demonstration. Let's see what that produces, just out of interest. There you go. So I've specified embedded an embedded how link to another person. As it happens, it's the same person. It makes no sense. But you know, you could link to another person. I've inlined the content of that person into here. I've created a link to self. If you don't want to link to self, you can link to self and to another person. And then we have a couple of different links. So you can create your complete navigable JSON API all through JSON views, which is pretty cool, I think. That's JSON views. JSON views are, as I said, they're pre-compiled for production environment as well. So we pre-compiled them using Gradle for production. In Grails 3.2 and JSON views 1.1, there's a whole bunch of new features, template inheritance, global templates, pagination. Check out the docs at that link. I want to discuss the Angular profile now. So the Angular profile extends the REST profile. So using the same backend, it extends that and it adds project setup for AngularJS and code generation for AngularJS. You get Angular specific commands, so create ng controller, create ng service, and let's see if I can get a brief demo of this going. This demo scares me the most, so let's pray to the demo gods that. So what you can do is run create app Angular test and use the Angular profile. Step into that. Let's open it up in our Grails interactive mode. And what I can do is create the main class called person. And we're going to have first name, last name. Then let me just copy this package name. I'm going to generate all person, so that'll generate my backend templates. And I'm then going to run ng generate all person to generate my Angular front end UI. See how that goes. And finally, in the URL mappings, I'm just going to add a person resources, person mapping. There we go. So that makes sense. So I think the only thing that we have to really get done here is in the Angular app, we've got it should be fine. So that creates my Angular module. You can see that inside my Angular module here, we got a reference to angular/test/person. And we got a person directory with my generated Angular controllers for the different, you got an Angular domain, which represents a person and interacts with my backend Grails application. So let's run this and see what we get. Okay, here is my Angular app. We can see we have a application controller and a person controller. We click on it. This is all within our Angular app. Create a person, we list the people. If we try and create a person without all the appropriate fields, We get a validation error back from the Grails app that, with the appropriate response populated into the Angular front end. The demo gods have been kind. Okay, there you go. So that's Angular scaffolding. Pretty cool, I would say. Okay, now I want to talk a bit about GORM 5. So Grails 3.1, we introduced GORM 5. With GORM re-architected based on traits. In my previous talk, I explained some of the benefit of that. With traits in GORM 5, it's much easier to understand the GORM API. There's a GORM entity trait that defines all of the GORM methods, both instance and static methods. It's easy to navigate the implementation of those. The IDE understands navigating into the trait. It's easy to document because we can document just using standard Groovy doc. There's no need to create a reference section in the Grails docs that was separate. So GORM 5 based on traits has really been a big win. We support Hibernate 5 and recently Hibernate 5.1, MongoDB 3, Neo4j 2.3, and Cassandra. GORM 5 for Hibernate, simultaneous release supporting still Hibernate 3. Maybe we'll be able to drop Hibernate 3 support one day. 4, 5, and 5.1. Completely rewritten based on traits, as I said. And simultaneous releases for Grails 2, Grails 3, Spring Boot, and standalone. So GORM 5 is usable not just from Grails 3, but also from Grails 2.5. So we did a simultaneous release. One of the few plugins releases that we do for both Grails 2 and Grails 3. GORM 5 for MongoDB, we rewrote the MongoDB implementation. So previously, in previous versions of GORM for MongoDB, what we would do is we would take a object and convert the object into a document, a MongoDB document, and the document would be serialized to MongoDB. And then the other way around, when you retrieved a document from MongoDB, we would convert the document to an object and read it. But with GORM for MongoDB 5, GORM 5 for MongoDB, what we do is we integrate directly with the codec engine from MongoDB. So we actually deserialize and serialize the JSON stream directly into your objects. This means that it's far more efficient and fast. GORM 5 is extremely fast, as close to native MongoDB driver support as is possible. And it converts, saves massive amounts of memory because we don't have to read both the object, the document, and the object. And it's extremely efficient. We worked in GORM 5 on Neo4j support for 2.3 that's built on top of Cypher, and it supports the embedded, the REST, and the HA modes. Again, that was released simultaneously to the different supported runtimes. And today, we want to announce, as I said, GORM 6, which is the next major version of GORM that will be included with Grails 3.2. Again, I want to note that all of the features that I've been talking about today, you can use in Grails 3.1. So if you're happy in Grails 3.1 and you don't want to use the milestone, you can add the GORM 6 milestone to your Grails 3.1 app and use it. You can add the Angular scaffolding to your Grails 3.1 app and use it. Grails 3.2 just packages all those things nicely together for you and makes them more out of the box. In terms of GORM 6, we're adding native MongoDB Rx support. So we have a new implementation of GORM that we're calling Rx GORM. It's GORM for Rx Java essentially, and based on top of Rx Java. And we're launching Rx GORM with two implementations. one for MongoDB and one for as a REST client. And both of those implementations will be part of Grails 3.2 and GORM 6. In the future, we plan to add support as well for SQL databases as well, based on some of the Postgres reactive drivers that exist out there. In addition, in GORM 6, we're introducing support for Neo4j 3 and the Bolt driver and native multi-tenancy support. So in terms of RxGORM is, as I said, GORM for RxJava. It's a reactive implementation that doesn't block. Previously, in previous versions of GORM, we did have an asynchronous feature, which allowed you to isolate your GORM queries onto a different thread pool that you manage. But those operations were still fundamentally blocking. With RxGORM, it is truly a non-blocking implementation that's building on top of the native Rx drivers, for example, for MongoDB. When we do the REST client implementation, we'll be building on top of something like RxNetty or directly on Netty itself. When we do the SQL implementation, we'll be building directly on the Rx drivers for Postgres or RxJDBC. So completely non-blocking, also lightweight. The focus is to be able to easily bootstrap RxGORM without necessarily needing a Spring application context or anything like that. So it's designed to be stateless, non-blocking, low memory, fast, and let's give you a demo and see how that goes. Okay, so I have a project here, and it's not a Grails project. It's a standard build.gradle, and what I have is just a dependency in here on, as you can see, on GORM RX MongoDB. Yeah, that's all I have in here, 6.0 milestone 1, and the repository, and I'm pointing, it's using the Gradle application plugin, and I'm pointing to my application class in here. So pretty trivial, just the build.gradle helped me set up in an IDE in IntelliJ, nothing else involved here. So one of the things in RxGORM is it's also trait-based. So there is a notion of an Rx entity. An Rx entity is essentially a GORM entity that is based on RxGORM. So any entity that you create would, as a minimum, implement this trait. There is a sub-trait, or I guess you would call it, subclass, sub-trait. Don't think we've defined that yet, called Rx Mongo entity, that extends Rx entity and adds additional capabilities that are specific to MongoDB. So what you can do is, you can create classes, you can I'm going to mark it as an entity using the entity annotation, and I'm going to say that it implements Rx Mongo entity. There we go. So it's implementing my trait. Now, in the case of Mongo entities, Rx GORM, you need to either have an object ID as the ID or a string. So in this case, I'm going to use an object ID. And as I said before, we wanted to make Rx GORM as simple as possible to get going. So the way you start using it is there's a Rx Mongo Datastore client class, and this client class has a bunch of constructors that allow you to bootstrap Rx GORM. Now, in the most simple case, the only thing I have to feed in here is the name of the database and my classes that make up my domain model. Yeah, So if you were using Grails, this would be done for you. You wouldn't have to do this. The Grails would just configure this automatically. But since I'm demonstrating this outside of Grails, that's all you have to do. Once that is done, we can start testing out GORM, RX GORM. So you'll notice that if I create a new entity here, that is of type person, you can see that we can call save on it just like in a regular Grails application. Yeah. The difference being that in a regular GORM application, the difference being that the save method in RX GORM will return an RX observable. Yeah. So why is that significant? That is significant because an observable is a reactive component that you can subscribe to. And it's important that you actually do subscribe to the save call, because if you don't, nothing will actually be executed. You as minimum have to subscribe or do something or transform or something to the observable. So we can call save and just print out person. And we can call save. So let's check out what happens if we run this. So when we run that, oh my goodness, I have no output. What happened? Okay, so remember what I said, that RX GORM is completely non-blocking and reactive. So my script actually exited before it had a chance to execute this command in the background thread. So we can kind of get around that by sleeping for a little bit and waiting for my operation to complete, although that's probably not very reliable, but for the purposes of this demonstration, that'll serve. There you go. You see it saved my object, my RX GORM entity. If you then later want to query, you can call list, and again, you can subscribe to and get a list of all the people that come back. And you run that, and we get the people that come back. There's actually more people because I had been playing with this before in my previous talk. If we want to make sure that we start with the clean data set, we can use db drop to blocking first. So you'll notice that call to to blocking, that's actually something you can do. So I could do print line person.list.toBlocking.first, and that will convert my observable into a blocking operation. Now, generally, you don't want to do that, because in a real-world app, you want to not block, right? You want to be reactive and so forth and so on. So that's useful for testing and so forth, but when using GORM, RX GORM, but in your real-world application, you would want to avoid blocking. So another interesting part of this is that the list method, as you can see, returns a entire deserialized list of people, which might, you know, you might have millions of people in your database. You don't necessarily want that, because you would probably quickly run out of memory. But what you can do is, instead of calling list, you call find all, subscribe, and that method, instead of returning a list, returns an individual person. And what it will do is, essentially reactively send you each person as they are deserialized. Thus, you wouldn't run out of memory even when reading millions of records, for example, in your query. It's like a callback, right? The integration with GORM for MongoDB is really deep. So for example, you can create where queries, and we can say first name equals Fred. And the return type here is, as you can see, a detached criteria, but the detached criteria is from the Rx package. So what we get back is a criteria object. And with this criteria object, you can apply additional logic to it. For example, you can say equals last name Flintstone or whatever. And then you can call find all. And again, you get an observable back, you see, back from the detached criteria, which you can subscribe to and do whatever you want with it, yeah? So there's a whole bunch of ways where you can compose non-blocking queries where, for example, let's see. For example, you can do stuff like person where first name equals, or let's do last name instead, equals Flintstone, find, it'll give me an observable back, and then you can do stuff like switch map using the Rx API, and the Rx API, the switch map method, expects you to return another observable, which somebody can subscribe to. So once you get the result of that, you can use that person to, for example, find all people that have the same last name and do a find all. So using this technique, I'm essentially returning an observable from the switch map method and creating a completely chain of non-blocking queries that propagate through to Rx GORM. Okay, so that is the Rx GORM demo. So as I said, we have huge plans for the future of the platform, from GORM 6 to the profile mechanism. We're going to keep extending Grails' capability via the profiles so that you can solve more and more use cases with the platform. Grails is far more than just a web framework. It's easy to classify it as that. But how many web frameworks out there provide you with command line code generation, backend persistence via engine via GORM? You know, it's the most trivial thing in the world to write an HTTP server. Every man and his dog is doing it. Grails is far more than an HTTP server. It's a whole suite of tools that help you solve a wide variety of problems. And we're going to continue evolving it, improving it, and improving the capabilities from GORM to Rx GORM, to the utilities to help you build rich front ends using tools like AngularJS, potentially React in the future. And we're evolving it to tackle new challenges. But you guys and the community are a key part of that. And we're extremely reliant on the community and the plugin ecosystem to help us move the platform forward. So, as always, the Grails community is phenomenal in the way that it contributes to the evolution of the framework. And the plugins out there, I think, for Grails 3, we've gone past the 150 plugin mark, which is good considering it's only been out for just over a year. And it continues to grow. The plugin system is as important as ever. It's a great way to contribute. And now you've got two great ways to contribute. So you can now contribute well, there's many ways you can contribute, but in terms of concretely, you've got plugins, which obviously is a great way to contribute to the community, but you've also got profiles. So, you know, that's something that that is completely extensible with Grails as well. And of course, you know, just reporting issues, just feeding back is absolutely a huge contribution to what we're doing. So if you're using Grails 3 and you encounter an issue, let us know, report the problem to our issue tracker, engage with the community on Slack, and we'll be happy to help and appreciate the feedback. Thank you very much. Any Q&A? So I think we still have the T-shirt giveaway, the OCI T-shirt giveaway, but I do have time for questions as well, so we'll do that simultaneously.
I'll pop up with a microphone.
Okay, so I see you have a quite a large templates for the HAL JSON templates. Do you have any plans for supporting JSON API, which is kind of similar objectives but slightly different JSON structure?
Yeah, so JSON API was something that I think it came out of the Rails community because they, once again, didn't like what the Java community was doing with HAL and created something else. But anyway, JSON API is something that would be nice to support. The good thing is the JSON views, that it's extensible. So you can apply traits to your JSON views. So I can imagine us, for example, having a plugin that provides a trait to add support for JSON API as an additional plugin to that ecosystem. So that would be a cool thing to do, definitely.
Okay.
Question of it?
The Angular scaffolding, was that Angular 1 or Angular 2?
Yeah, so initially we are doing Angular 1. Angular 2 is not GA yet. But the approach, I think, with Angular 2 would be different because they're very different. Initially, we are working on a Webpack profile, which then we would be able to base an Angular 2 profile and React profile on. And again, but we're trying to make the Angular 1 scaffolding as generic as possible so that we can reuse as much of it as possible for Angular 2. So the infrastructure pieces are being made generic, and then it'll just be the outputs that change for Angular 2. So we do have Angular 2 support planned out there, and I think Angular 2 should be going GA soon, no?
Yeah, I just hit beta, like...
It's a beta at the moment. So
yes, like a couple weeks ago, I think.
Yeah. But. So as soon as that's more concrete, then we will we don't want to be chasing something that's moving. So as soon as it's more concrete, we'll look at building.
Anybody else?
So RxGom, can we use it with GOM and? Because when you're dealing with in the context of a controller, you might need to switch.
So the question is, can you use RxGorm with normal GORM? So yes, all you have to do is make sure your entities that are using RxGorm implement, for example, RxMongo entity or Rx entity, and then those entities will be mapped with RxGorm. We are also planning in Grails 3.2 to add additional support for returning observables from controllers to make it easier to write controllers that work with observables. So that'll be one of the features in Grails 3.2. But in the meantime, you can, just by implementing the RxMongo entity interface, that entity will become an Rx entity instead.
Yeah, last question.
So if you have plans for implementing this observable pattern up in the controllers, will that also propagate all the way to the views? So you somehow can have dynamic views out of the box somehow?
Probably. I don't think it's necessary to propagate it to views. The way we see it is that typically you want to formulate your model in a non-blocking way and then render the view. So at the controller level, the support is all about waiting for the observable to complete, and then the observable would become your model that you pass to the view. The result of the observable will become the model to pass to your view. So in the case of JSON, you would return an object, and that would then be passed to your JSON view, and then you render that. But the whole view rendering is done in a non-blocking way, as a response to the as a subscriber to the observable. If that makes sense.